Ever the meaning, the functions of the goddess, we have to concentrate on one area which is rich in sculptural art or say painted pottery and others like Europe. And then we can be certain that we can understand the symbolism. Although in general, no question, there are similarities between Africa and Europe and the Near East and Americas. Indian art, of course, has very, very much similarities to European images. In China, of course, also before the patriarchal period was a goddess religion. Southeast Asia is full of images which are almost identical. The pottery is so similar that it can be confused with what is in say, Romania or Hungary and in Indonesia.
Maria, I'm not sure you're aware, but over the last 20 years or so, the rediscovery of the goddess has been the catalyst for a vast new religious movement, which is being regarded as the fastest growing religious movement in America today, the religion of the living goddess. I would wonder if you might have any comments about this new movement, the resurgence of goddess worship, and a projection of how you see that for the future.
Why it was in the past so slow and why it is so fast now, yes? That's interesting. Well, of course, one thing is the feminist movement, and women are helping to spread the idea, that is clear. And another is that the material became ripe for interpretation. There is so much that I always question, how come that for so long nobody really touched the question of symbolism or types of goddesses? There of course, is a lot written before me and about Near Eastern goddesses and others, but this analysis of types and symbols was not done. So why? Well, perhaps someone like me, who was interested in interdisciplinary studies, had to appear to connect what is known in mythology, in Indo-European studies, in history of religions, in archaeology, in linguistics, and pull all the chords together. It needs an interdisciplinary view, otherwise it is difficult to understand. All of my colleagues are not interested in figurines or sculptures or religion in general. They just discard. This is no interest, no interpretation. Better not do it because you will not be a scientist.
What impact in the world? How would this affect the
right
world?
Now? Right. Well, I think we reached the end of the world and we are starting to create another. Well, I expect we shall become a healthier society. We shall worship the earth, well, not in the same way. Nothing returns from the past. We cannot repeat the whole thing from the beginning. We can only transform ourselves and use our knowledge about the past and apply it for the creating the future. This is my feeling.
In other talks, I've heard you talk about the fact that the old goddess cultures that you've been speaking about did not know warfare. They didn't have weapons. The invention of warfare was really an invention of the patriarchal sky god cultures that came later. Could you just briefly outline the evidence for that and how you view that story?
Yes, it is true. This culture is a peaceful culture. We have no weapons except for hunting. Arrowheads exist, and even one or two daggers have been found, but These are not for warfare. Whereas in the East, the Kurgan culture produced formidable daggers around, say, 5000 BC and later. And then from the daggers, swords developed, and then they had spears and other weapons. Whereas in Europe, we do not have weapons until the appearance of the warriors. Then after that, of course, the culture was transformed and the weapons appeared, together with the specific type of metallurgy which appeared in Europe at the end of the fourth millennium or the second half of the fourth millennium. The metal was, well, what we can call now bronze, but it was first arsenic and copper, and this was a hard metal. The metal used before by all the Europeans was a soft metal. It was copper and gold. And from that kind of metal, you could not produce weapons. And the most important evidence for a peaceful culture is the location of habitation sites. They chose the best, the beautiful areas. They didn't even think of enemies. They didn't have to climb up the hills. They didn't have to fortify their settlements with stone walls. If they fortified, it was just a trench or some palisade against the wild animals, maybe. That was all.
Maria, is there any evidence that you can use to get an idea of what the balance between male and female was in the family and in society in old Europe?
Well, we can reconstruct something. Of course, not the whole picture, because it's in archaeological records, it's difficult to find such a good evidence for that. Well, we can use settlements, we can use cemeteries, we can use frescoes and other sources. I would say it's important to see what happened in Crete, in Terra, in the Bronze Age, and there we have so many frescoes that we can reconstruct the society. And this is a balanced society with a woman as a priestess on the top and as a queen. And I think it's no doubt that the Minoan culture had a queen, and her brother maybe was very important for trade and navigation. And I would then go back and see from the settlement and cemetery evidence in Europe of the 6th, 5th, 4th, 3rd millennia, that there was a balanced society where men were important. They were overseeing trade and perhaps architecture, building, shipbuilding, navigation, tool making. In their graves, always there appear trade objects. Whereas in important female graves, the cult objects, symbols, appear. Also, in many areas of Europe have been found women's graves, which were, very important in the sense that the whole mound, long mound, was on top of a single woman. Such appear in Poland, for instance, in so-called funnel neck beaker culture. In Hungary, there are found graves where models of temples were found in women's graves. So there is a lot of evidence which shows that the woman is connected with the temple. She is important in the religious movement. She is the overseer of the temple. And this was actually a theocracy, or theocracy, where women were the leaders of religious life. But then men also served in rituals, judging from Terran frescoes, where there are processions of men, or men bringing gifts to the goddess, carrying fish from from, you know, their fishing and bringing to the goddess. So that, in other words, I would agree with Rihanna Eisler's term, gilani or gilani, composed of gi and an, woman and man, and el in the middle, linking the two sexes. However, maybe in the very beginning there was not a real balanced society. I think the woman was more important because of the goddess. And because the mother was really very important. And the father was just a consort. And the brother of the family took care of the children, probably. He was the important, and the linguistic evidence shows it. The brother of the mother is always in this non-Indo-European remnants of the language. Well, I think what I have shown to you in my slides and said, it is a part of what is possible to say about the goddess religion of old Europe. Of old Europe, which existed before the Indo-Europeans. I identify this term with a non-Indo-European culture, not Indo-Europeans. This was a goddess civilization, I would dare to say. Because it reached a culmination around the 5th and 4th millennia BC, and I don't agree with the definition of the civilization, that the civilization begins with the warriors in Europe, with the production of weapons and building of hill forts. I think this is an ideal culture, a peaceful, stable, long-lasting civilization from which we can learn a lot.